Good morning, viewers, and welcome to CEC-UGC EduSat Network. And we are running a series on Indian writing in English translation. And already we have done a large number of lectures on various texts and trends that existed in India right from the ancient period. And now we are in the middle of it, and we will be soon coming to the end of this series, which has been liked by viewers quite a bit. And today we take up the important topic of a modern writer in Odia, who was there in the late 19th and early 20th centuries. And this writer, his name is Fakir Mohan Senapati, a well-known name, and he represented a trend, and he was a true voice of his times, and he represented the reality of the region to which he belonged in a manner that became national in character. So we have for this lecture the resource person, Dr. Richa Bajaj. She teaches English literature in Hindu College, Delhi University, and she has done a lot of work on Indian writing as well as Shakespeare. Her book on Muktibodh, the Hindi poet, is a well-known book today, and it's called Muktibodh in Our Time. So without taking more time, I request Dr. Richa Bajaj to please present his lecture. So welcome, Dr. Bajaj, and please give your lecture.
Thank you very much, Dr. Anprakash. Hello, viewers, and I welcome you once again to another lecture on Indian writing in English translations. Today, I am going to speak to you about, the Odia writer, Fakir Mohan Senapati. Now, in the context, for Senapati, it is important that we understand what was 19th century like in Odisha and, what kind of sensibility emerged at the time. And also, just to see how this person, Fakir Mohan Senapati, he becomes the, he's like the father of Odia literature. And he's known, he did a pioneering work in, in the field of literature, in the field of education, and also in the field of social reform. So, he was at once this kind, this dynamic personality. He was an educationist, he was a literateur, and he was a social reformer. So all these things combine in him, and you cannot see him only as a literateur. In fact, you can't see him as only a literature person. He's in fact more of a social reformer who finds his voice in literature and finds a way and a medium to talk to the masses through the medium of literature. So this is important in the sense that just to understand how Odia literature began. And Odia literature has been there. It's not to say that before Senapati, no kind of literature has been written. But he's first of his kind because he's a modern voice. He's a modern voice, in the sense that he talks about the concerns of the people. And, his concerns are, focus is on the common people. He's not talking about some traditional knowledge. And in fact, there is a kind of, just as we find this kind of a, blend of tradition and modernity in all writers who belong to this phase of Indian literature, we find this in Senapati as well. He tries to bring together aspects of tradition and modernity. In fact, he tries to understand, he tries to also at the same time, judge the validity of both tradition and modernity in the context of Odisha. And, he's majorly known as a fiction writer. It's the first short story of Odia literature is known to be Revati, the one that he wrote, and he's famous for that. So, he has a kind of a historical value as well. And it's not just limited to, the kind of works he wrote or the importance as such of the work, but for its historical value, that he was a pioneer, in this field of talking about the concerns of the common people, using the idiom of the common people, and at the same time, bringing in some aspects of the folk literature, the folk oral as oral literature that has always, prevailed in Odisha, bringing it together with the modern concerns. So Fakir Mohan Senapati was very well read, and he would often talk about in his works. He would quote, you know, from different sources, Western sources as well. So, you know, he was a very well-read man as well. So, in this sense, you know, he was able to bring the principles of Western rationality. He was able to bring together, you know, the positive, constructive, you know, approach of Western literature and bring it on the to the Indian context, and specifically in the, you know, in the sphere of Odisha. Now, let me speak to you about, you know, the Odia sensibility as it emerged. What happened in the 19th century? How did, you know, Odia, you know, the Odisha get its, or people of Odisha actually get their, you know, identity? In fact, you know, a lot of people, you know, have spoken about this kind of Odia sensibility that has emerged in the, particularly in the 19th century. You know, it is assumed that before the 19th century, the Odia people did not think of themselves as one unit. You know, they were disintegrated. So there was the rules of the Mughals, then the rules of the Marathas, and then they came the British. Now, the British came to Odisha in 1803. Now, when they came to Odisha, there's a kind of a change that takes place in the 19th century and, you know, the decades following the occupation of Odisha by the British. You know, there is a kind of change that takes place. Now, what is that change? You see, when the Mughals were there, when the Marathas ruled, of course, there was great suffering and they did exploit the common people, and, you know, not that they were happy under those rules. But, you know, what happened when the British came to occupy Odisha was that, you know, people's livelihoods changed. Now, when I say people's livelihoods changed, what do I mean? You know, it's just that people who were involved in the cottage industries, you know, such as the handloom, the handicrafts, the very native arts of Odisha, that which made the community, you know, have its own kind of identity, these were completely wiped out, you know, and they disappeared from the scene with the advent of the British in Odisha. Now, the second important, so that was one area of the arts and crafts, and people thrived, you know, they made their livelihood through these through this enterprise. Now, then on the other hand, you had people living in the coastal regions, you know, they stayed in the coastal regions. Now, the British came up with the Sunset Law, and, you know, it was quite infamous, and they restricted, they took complete monopoly over the salt, the common salt from the coastal regions, and they did not allow the natives to use that salt that was theirs, you know, for since forever. And they and so there was this, you know, they put restrictions on the sale and manufacturing of common salt, and they put their whole, you know, they monopolized that region. Now, people were again driven out of their source of livelihood. People again had to move away from these regions, and they had only known this kind of life. So the British, in a way, changed their way of living. You know, they were uprooted from the place that they lived in. The third important area is the land. Now, the British also came in, brought in this revenue, you know, on the land. And in fact, they did not allow people to own lands. They put this kind of their revenue policy, disallowed people to own lands and also to make any kind of money to thrive on the land. And because of it, and it was not just the rich, the peasantry that suffered, even the rich landlords suffered. In fact, most of them, what they did was that they took lands in the name of the religious heads. And, you know, these religious, because the British had a policy of not interfering with religious affairs, or, you know, interfering with, you know, the religious institutions. So they did not enter that zone. So any land that was occupied, that was owned by a religious head or a religious institution, was not touched by the British. So, you know, these rich landlords found way of attaining land through these means. But obviously, you know, then there was how honest were these, you know, heads, how honest were the priests with these rich landlords, again became very questionable, because then they refused to give the land back. What I'm trying to talk about when I talk about these different areas is that there was a state of complete turmoil in Odisha in the 19th century, particularly in the decades following British occupation of the region. Now, this turmoil led to a kind of, discontent, and also this kind of, uprootedness that people felt. They were displaced, and there was large-scale displacement. People moved to, so then what happened? As a result, a large section of the population moved to agriculture, to the land. land, and they were forced to then till the land. And you know, then comes the zamindari system that was already in place, and how these people who earlier had different ways of procuring their livelihood were forced to work on the land, and the land that they did not belong to them, and for which they got a very meager sum. And what, and even the zamindars, the local zamindars, whoever were there, even they fleeced the peasantry. So you see, this is a kind of a very it's a kind of a crisis situation in Odisha at the time. And this is the time when people of the region start, begin to protest, begin to, think about their own concerns, think about their own community. So this is with regard to the socio-economic, conditions of the people in Odisha. The other important aspect that, comes out in this region, and this is post, 1850 or so, this is when, Fakir Mohan Senapati becomes an active figure in the cultural scene in Odisha. You see, what happens in the later decades, towards the close of the century, is that, the Odia language also comes under threat. Now, what happens is that, there's this kind of debate that moves around that, Odia is not even a language, and that it is only a dialect of Bangla, and that it should, we should take away the status of an independent language from Odia. Now, that appeared to be a major threat to the community through its life. And this is when there were a lot of rebellions and a lot of protests that, in the 60s, 1860s and 70s, this is the time when the protests take place, and people start rebelling against the idea of being submerged into, the Bangla language. So this linguistic submersion of Odia that was being planned was stalled by, figures, people like Fakir Mohan Senapati and others, other fellow writers who, voiced concerns against it, who protested against such an enterprise. Now, when these people protested, they actually brought out an entire movement to preserve the culture of Odisha. And this is when, so this is exactly, this is the time when, this is the time when the Odia people realize that they have their own kind of sensibility, they have an identity, and they must work to preserve it. So a kind of Odia sensibility emerges at this particular time in history. Now, let me take you through some of the dates which are important in terms of, the Odia culture. So if, if I could talk about this particular date. So, another important thing happened actually. Let me speak to you about this one important thing that took place as well. This was the advent of Christian missionaries in Odisha in 1822. Before that, there's a quote. Let's look at this quote. By the second half of the century, the people were dependent almost entirely on agriculture for their living. These Odia areas, however, were largely treated as the backwaters of the provinces they were attached to, with no railway lines or irrigation systems being set up by the administrators to develop them. So that is also so by the second half of the people were dependent on agriculture for their living, as I told you earlier, that they were driven out of their home, their places, the coastal regions. Now, interestingly, another thing happens at the time, which I did not mention, which was about the Christian missionaries. Now, obviously, the British brought in a lot of suffering and displaced the community. All of that happened. But, there was something important and significant and positive that happened with the advent of the Christian missionaries in Odisha in 1822. Because they were the ones who, willfully and with a lot of fervor tried to establish schools and colleges, universities in these neglected regions. So you have the first Odia Bible, which was published in 1811, and by 1836, you have the first printing press that is set up. Now, with the printing press, a whole new world opens up, the world of culture, the world of literature, the world of education, and, primary, secondary education becomes, in the sense, becomes very easy and accessible to the people. In fact, when we when I speak about Rebati, the short story of Fakir Mohan Senapati, you will realize that, there it's all about the education of a young girl. And how a primary school is set up in the region with the help of top level these native people who are intellectuals in their own right. And Fakir Mohan Senapati also worked with the officers in place to bring about a kind of a cultural revolution in Odisha, to bring about a kind of educational reform in the region. So that is very important when we look at the Odia context. When we look in the India Odia context, the role of Christian missionaries is also equally important, because they are the ones who actually give fillip to this kind of educational reform in the region. Because of them, there were a lot of these areas were otherwise, these villages and small towns and provinces were relegated to the margins. In fact, in the story Rebati, where the village that we are talking about, that's a very remote kind of a village where there is no medical facility available and no access, no railway line, nothing. It's a disconnected kind of a place. And it is here that the epidemic actually of cholera takes place, and this, it wipes out the family of Rebati. And there is a kind of a tragedy that unfolds because of that. So I will speak about the story, but just to give you a kind of a view that how remote and distant these villages are, and out of the central world, out of this mainstream world, which was the focus of the British and the administrators, they brought about facilities which in a way helped them, but with regard to the villages, the small towns, they paid no attention. So here the Christian missionaries actually played an important and significant role in this particular region. Another important thing that happened at the turn of the century, this is the late 19th century, is the emergent middle class that comes to the fore. Now you will find that the emergent middle class of the late 19th century took tradition along with them while moving in the direction of modernity. So this is also an interesting point. Now, you see, before that, now that we are on this page, unification of the people of Odisha happened, when there was people were trying to de-recognize the Odia language. I've spoken about that. And there were protests, etc., that took place. And the famine of 1866 killed a large part of the population, and it further organized the community to fight for its rights. So this is what I spoke about earlier, how the unification of Odisha, how the sensibility of Odia people actually emerged. So you see, with the rise of the middle class in the region, there is something interesting that takes place again, that this is a class that is interested in education, this is a class that is interested in the new ideas, and is not taken over, is not in the grips of superstition or old hierarchies based on caste, and is ready to move further forward. And there is this kind, so the person who in a way symbolizes in Rebati is Rebati's father. So Rebati's father is interested in giving education to his 10-year-old daughter. And so he thinks of, he's moving in the direction of modernity, while still he has a grandmother at home who he's providing for, and he's a sustaining a family. So you see, he's in a way in between the grandmother and the daughter. The grandmother symbolizes, of course, tradition, and she goes on saying in Rebati that in the story Rebati, that why does this girl need education, what for, what is she going to do with this education? But Shyambandhu, the father, is able to see the light, is able to see the new direction being provided to them at the turn of the century, and he decides to give education to Rebati. So you see, this kind of blend of tradition and modernity that we see is seen in this emergent middle class in Odisha in the late 19th century. It is also this class that is going to involve itself with creation of ideas, with sustaining the culture and preserving the culture. It is interestingly this class to which Senapati belongs, and other writers belong, who are going to look to, who are going to preserve the Odia culture. So the middle class in a way has a very interesting role to play in the 19th century India, And here I'd actually like to take the view of Dr. Anand Prakash, since he has worked in this area, about the, you know, how the middle class, what role does this emergent middle class play in the 19th century in the Indian context? How would you respond to it?
I think this is a very important role that middle class plays. Peasantry is busy, you know, on the fields. The traders work in the towns. The political leaders and reformers, they are taking stock of the situation at the social and political level. But the culture, the question of language, literature, these are somehow able to engage the attention of the middle class. In fact, it's a very important point you are making, because still the middle class emerges in history. And there's no middle class, for instance, in Odisha or in India for that matter, in the earlier centuries. And middle class is a phenomenon in the 19th century. Therefore, modernity is bound to come, because middle class will think about these issues in a manner that no other section of society can think. So here, as you have rightly pointed out, there is a crisis. And the crisis is in economy, the crisis is in politics, the crisis is in society, and the crisis also is in language. Which language should the Odia people use? In their normal life, they are using the dialect. The dialect has some roots in Bangla. But if Bangla starts encroaching upon the sensibility of people through its overall, you know, superiority, and if the dialect is pushed to the background, then there will be once again a kind of situation in which literature of the masses, literature of the poor people will not emerge. So Fakir Mohan Senapati, as you indicate, is able to take this issue in such a manner that people's literature is presented in people's language. And you know, that gives a kind of identity, a very positive identity to the Odia people. Otherwise, Odia people as people will not exist. So I think the point that you are making is very valuable, and through this point only we can understand the nature of the crisis in Odia writing and Odia society.
Yes. So in a way, Fakir Mohan Senapati provides a cultural viewpoint to this entire, Odia sensibility or Odia identity. Mm-hmm. He is that important culture point that Matthew Arnold perhaps talked about, mm-hmm. you know, where culture plays an important role, and how, the carriers of culture need to preserve this kind of identity.
In fact, culture envelops within its fold the idea of literature. You know, literature is supposed to talk about people's views, their opinions, their values, their pattern of life. And for this, you know, no other class in society has time to think. And they don't have the wherewithal, they don't have the knowledge. So middle class spares this time, understands the language, goes to the experiences, suffers, identifies the feelings, and then expresses those feelings in literature. So Matthew Arnold is right that, you know, in the 19th century England, when the under the Victorian regime, middle class emerged in a big way, a large number of the educated people came forward, then they were given the idea of defining for themselves and for others their attitudes, their opinions. So without attitudes and opinions, you can't think of literature, you can't think of proper writing. In fact, you should be telling either in this section of the lecture or later as to how, you know, prose comes into being.
Yeah.
So prose means that words from the ordinary life will be brought in, and the way people speak, because people speak in prose, and if writers start using prose for expressing themselves in literature, then a new kind of literature emerges. Now,
yes.
There will be no emphasis on poetry. There might be emphasis now on prose writing and short stories and novels that people write.
Mm. So is it a kind of a self-fashioning that is taking place, you know?
Mm-hmm.
One understands, one has a feeling that, you know, Fakir Mohan Senapati is a voice of culture in the Odia context.
Mm-hmm.
And that, you know, he's in fact constructing a kind of an Odia identity and an Odia sensibility through this kind of a work. And interestingly, as you say, culture, he's not just a literature person. You know, he's a person who, he's a social reformer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and at first perhaps he's a social reformer, he's an educationist, he's a journalist, and all of that. So, you know, in this sense, I feel that he's playing that important role of a person who's, furthering the cause of, the Odia life, and also the Indian context. You know, if we connect the Odia sensibility and Odia identity with the Indian identity and the Indianness, because he also talks about colonialism, nationalism, and zamindari system, which is what I feel Premchand is going to do in the 20th century, you know, later on, just in a matter of some decades, you will have Premchand who's going to take up a similar work, in Hindi literature.
Dr. Bada, I would like you to slightly explain for the benefit of the viewers the concept of self-fashioning, because this is a good word, this is a good phrase that you use, as to what exactly you mean by self-fashioning.
Of course, self-fashioning has been used for the Renaissance, you know, in the English Renaissance, and it is used, it means that you are constructing and producing yourself, you know, your self-fashioning doesn't have to do with dress or image. It's the overall persona that a person tries to carve out, you know, and it is this kind of, you know, conscious carving out of the self. And the conscious and self then can be extended to the area of the community. It's this conscious carving out of the self of the community, you know, in this case, the Odia community that I was referring to, that, you know, that Fakir Mohan Senapati is doing that important work that, you know, of constructing the self of Odia literature or constructing the self of Odia, you know, culture.
You also mentioned Renaissance. So yes. Do you think there is a kind of renaissance that is happening in Odisha at that time? A kind of new learning, a kind of new exploration?
Yes, that is true. With regard to their, you know, touch with modernity, you know, it's this kind of, you know, encounter with modernity that has brought in new explorations and new ideas to the region. And also we have to remember when the Christian missionaries came, then they brought in with, you know, there was of course the Odia Bible, but with that, you know, the use of the English language also seeped in, and with the language came in literature as well. So people were involved in this kind of cultural exchange where they came in touch with Western writers, English writers and English authors. So Senapati, for that reason, you know, has had a view of the new life or a different life that exists elsewhere, you know, in the world. And one has then a way of comparing and contrasting one's own life and the flaws and the, you know, the problems that exist in one's own sphere, which is why he was the first proponent and a very strong proponent of education, you know, primary education in Odisha. And, you know, he used the short story Rebati to put his point across. You know, that is my view of it.
And, you know, religion does not mean simply rituals. Religion,
yes,
also means education. Ritual means, religion means ideas. And if a new religion like Christianity is introduced in the, you know, life of Odisha, then people will start comparing and contrasting their belief systems with the one that is reflected in Christianity.
Yes, you are right there. In fact, in his novel, 6 Acres and a Half, he actually mentions how about the sacrifice of Christ, and he compares Christ's sacrifice with the sacrifice of Sita. So, you know, how he has brought in the Ramayana, how he has brought in the Bible, and, you know, kind of created a blend between the two in his work is also, and that blend is also not just in the books that he's writing, that blend is also there in the sensibility of you know, the persona that Fakir Mohan Senapati has, or for that matter, the, you know, the persona that that is being constructed by an intellectual at the time.
Which means that when two religions or three religions collide, clash, come together, a kind of possibility of blend is possible.
Yes.
And that blend is there not just in belief systems, it's also there in society.
Yes.
So that way, religion of this kind, the clash, the disagreement, that also contributes a great deal to the culture of the time. So now, viewers, with this particular argument that Dr. Bajaj presented, we come to the end of the first part of the lecture, and then we'll be exploring these ideas further as Dr. Bajaj is there to, you know, introduce concepts that belong to the next part of the argument. Thank you. So welcome back, viewers, and we now come to the second part of the lecture, and I would request Dr. Bajaj to once again give the points that she wants to share with you. Please, Dr. Bajaj.
Thank you, Dr. Anprakash. So viewers, let's look at some of the basic facts, and I wish to speak to you about the dates of Fakir Mohan Senapati as well. So he's born in 1843 and he's there till 1918. So we can see that, you know, how he's at this cusp and the kind of period of transition. You know, he's seen the 19th century world, and he's seen the 20th century world as well, that is beginning, that is taking shape in India, and this is an important period for India. So he's born in a coastal town in Balasore, and he's a social reformer, as I told you earlier, and an educationist, a journalist, a literateur. He's known as the pioneer of modern Odia fiction, and has played a significant role in Save Odia movement for the preservation of the language, that is Odia language and culture. He began, along with fellow writers, the Utkal Sabha in 1862, an organization that fostered Odia identity. So the concerns of his writing, he writes about village life and offers a critique of orthodoxy and caste, as also class hierarchies, colonialism and its clash with zamindari system, the exploitation of the peasantry. These are the concerns that you see in his writings. And his style is didactic as also epigrammatic, you know, and he chooses the didactic style. So, you know, these are the basic, pointers with regard to Fakir Mohan Senapati's works. He gets very satirical, in his novel 6 Acres and a Half, while in the story Rebati, he follows that tragic strain. So, these are the kind of tragedy, a kind of dark humor, and, a style which is, meant to give a kind of a moral message, and, didactic in that sense, he's telling you what to do, because, you see, he also realizes that the people of Odisha at the time are, are probably unaware of, the problems that exist in society. And he then spearheads this movement of creating awareness among the people through the medium of the story. Now, if we talk about the form of the short story, as we discussed earlier, then we find that the short story becomes a very interesting kind of a medium to express oneself, and it is different from drama, it is different from poetry, it is different from this classical Sanskrit styles that have prevailed, and it uses the language of the common people, using the idioms of the common people. Now, this is what we see in Rebati, the short story. We see a kind of a blend of the folktale and the short story. Now, when we say that we see a kind of blend of the folktale and the short story, what one is trying to suggest is that the new form of the story has already taken shape, and Fakir Mohan Senapati is providing a kind of a model through his story. But what is interesting is that he takes along certain aspects of the folktale into the story. So, he's a precursor in that sense of the short story form, and because he's using the tale as well, the popular folk tale which has survived and, in the memory of the Odia people. Now, the use of the folk tale might also be a kind of a conscious choice on the part of Fakir Mohan Senapati. Because when he uses the folktale, then he is able to, move directly and penetrate into the minds of the people, and is able to talk through the folktale, and bring in new ideas, new points into the folktale. So when he talks about, the story of Rebati, he starts by saying, once upon a time, there was this girl who lived in a village called Patpur, and, she lived with her father, her parents. So his tone, his form, the mode is very much of a folk tale, and it's very folklorish then, very much like an oral story. But what he wishes to say through the story is quite different. So that he uses the mode of the folk tale, but the content and the way the story spreads itself, it has a lot of the short story form, which will become the major form in the 20th century in Indian literature. Now, when we speak of specifically of the story Rebati, Rebati is a story of this young girl who's 10 years old and who's living with, her father and the mother and a grandmother. And they have a kind of scene that is provided to us in the beginning of the story is one which is of plenitude and of abundance. There is enough milk in the house. There is enough food in the house. They have a happy life. And the man, Shambandhu, is a very honest man, upright man. He works for zamindar and he's supposed to collect the zamindari from peasants, and he keeps some money with himself and then gives the money to the zamindar, and he's an honest person. He always keeps records of his works and gives bills to all the peasants, and so people trust him in that sense. And this person then decides to send his he hears that after this kind an officer stayed in Patpur village for a short while, and then the villagers and others convinced him to open a primary school there. So a school is opened and a teacher placed there, and this teacher's name is Basudev. Now this person Basudev becomes as important in the story as Rebati, because Shambandhu actually requests Basudev to come to his place and to teach Rebati the lessons, and to educate her, at least give her the primary education. And to this, objection is raised by the grandmother in the house, who fails to understand why the girl should get an education. She should learn the household chores, she should learn how to cook, she should learn other things in the house and not be educated. But Shambandhu does not listen to her and goes ahead with the education of the girl. Now what happens is, still this particular period of time in the story, everything is hunky-dory, everything is nice. But when we move further, we realize that, as the story progresses and she starts to learn, and, there's an equation between Basudev and Rebati as well. But, one realizes that, Fakir Mohan Senapati has something else to say. He's not just going to present to you a pleasant picture of a modern man who is accepting this new life and trying to educate the daughter. He introduces an element there. He introduces the element of the epidemic of cholera. Because of the epidemic of cholera, Shambandhu, he dies, and following his death, his wife also dies, and both mother and father dead. People start taking advantage of the situation. The zamindar takes away the land and the house, he takes away the work and the zamindari work away from the family. He in fact takes the cows away, the source of milk. The scene of abundance that we saw in the beginning was because of the cows, and he takes away that source from the family, saying that Shambandhu owed some money to him, which the reader is of course aware, because Shambandhu, being a man of integrity and honesty, would not keep a rupee with himself. And so you can see this kind of fleecing and this kind of exploitation taking place. Both the granddaughter now and the Rebati and the grandmother are left to fend for themselves, and Rebati has never ventured out of the house. She has remained within the domestic spheres and has never ventured out. It is at this point that Basudev becomes an important figure in the family, and he starts to bring in food for both the grandmother and Rebati. And every fourth or fifth day he would replenish the stores of the house for them to sustain themselves. So this is the story that goes on. But Senapati again is not just is not going to stop here. He's not going to say that, well, there was some kind of a tragedy, that there's some kind of affliction, but the family has been saved. No, he leaves no scope for the family to be saved. Next, we find that Basudev has been taken ill, and it's in fact the epidemic, the cholera has also taken him in its grips, and he also dies. With the death of Basudev and the father and the mother, you have this kind of a picture which is a dreadful picture. It's a tragic tale of Rebati and the grandmother. The grandmother goes out, she finds there is no food in the house. Rebati is ill. Meanwhile, we find that there's a kind of interesting a tinge of romantic relationship you find between Basudev and Rebati. And Rebati, when she hears that Basudev is no more, she refuses to eat, and finally she starves herself to death. And meanwhile, Meanwhile, the grandmother, who's half blind, she goes to fetch some food from the moneylender, sells the last pot in the house, and comes back only to find that Rebati is unconscious and is dead. And with that, she too falls unconscious. And we are told that that family was completely wiped out after that. Nobody heard of this family, and the story ends there. So you can see what kind of tragic tale has he built here. And Senapati does not stop at any moment to give you any kind of release, any kind of, you know, a kind of relief to the reader. The reader is, you know, it's a kind of a heart-wrenching tale, in fact, where the reader is pushed to, you know, he pushes the limit, and the reader is pushed to that extreme sense, you know, of believing that life can go in, you know, in this direction. In this story, what I have not spoken about is the role of education. Now, the grandmother, all through after the death of Chambandu and the you know, the mother, when the both when the parents are dead, the grandmother actually accuses Rebati and says that she has brought ill omen into the house. The grandmother actually suggests that it is because of the education that was being provided to Rebati that this kind of a misfortune has visited the family and has completely wiped out the family. And she blames her education, and she blames her, you know, learning, and she says that this is the cause of all evil in our family, and she holds Rebati responsible for that. Now, you know, a lot of people have then talked about Senapati's, view and Senapati's own position with regard to this story, whether he was in favor of education, whether he was in favor of women's education. You know, some of the, there has been work done on this from the woman's point of view, and where people have taken him and taken this story, Rebati, as the first example of a female literary tradition in Odia culture, Odia literature. You know, it is seen as the first female tradition. It's a story with that built this kind of a female literary tradition in Odisha. So, you know, people have spoken from that angle, but you know, and some of them have said that, well, Senapati is rather mixed up when he talks about the story of Rebati, whether it was about education, whether he gives he emphasizes the role of superstition, which has been exemplified in the character of the grandmother. So, and you know, that and some of them speak about the clash that exists between tradition and modernity as exemplified in the story. What is important is that Senapati talks about, you know, this society that exists at the time, the different attitudes that prevail at the time, and, you know, also the very physical manifestation of problems which is seen in the in the form of the cholera. Now, the epidemic, that there is no medical facility available in the premises, and that epidemics are still considered to be God's way of punishing people, is what he's trying to suggest. So, you know, science and the advent of science has done very little for villages like Patpur, where people die and entire villages are wiped out. You know, and of course the reference to the famine is also there, which wiped out again the community, the Odia community, a large chunk of it. So, you know, he's also criticizing this particular policy of the British government that refuses to provide any sort of medical facility or any kind of relief to the people there, and then also talking about the social attitudes of the native people, the Odia people, who have lived in the older times and are then symbols of orthodoxy, and who believe that it is God's way of punishing us, that, you know, that we should not accept anything from anything new, or not accept that which has not has ever happened.
Here I would like to say one or two things. First is, you know, that viewers, we'll have a discussion also, and you can present your point of view at 10:50, that is last 10 minutes. You can ask questions from Dr. Bajaj, and she would be glad to answer them. And we have a toll free number for this. The number is 1-800-110-430. So at 10:50 onwards, you can ask questions and she will answer. Secondly, I want to myself ask a question from you, Dr. Bajaj, and that is with respect to the form of folk tale. You went into it, and you made a very interesting point. The folk tale generally is, in my opinion, an expression of wisdom of the masses. And you know, there is generally a kind of a narrative that ends with an answer. There is a problem that is presented and the answer is given, and that's how the folktale functions. But you say that the writer is here experimenting with this form of giving an answer, of educating the masses. And the new part in it, according to you, as you pointed out, is that he is focusing upon the problems and the intensity of the feelings that they generate.
That's true.
Which is not there in the folktale.
Exactly.
So it's a new kind of a folktale in which the elements of modern reality, they are mixed with blended with, I'm using your word, blended with the folktale thing. So if that is the case, then is it because of this that he's introducing many characters and gives, you know, insights into their specific behaviors? Because generally in folktale, there will be one or two characters only.
Yeah, so you see, he has, there are not many characters as such of importance and significance that is in the story, Rebati. But yes, you know, as in the folktale, you know, a character represents a value system. Mm-hmm. As in a folktale, the character represents good, evil, or even represents orthodoxy. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a voice of Basudev becomes the voice of modernity, you know, the grandmother becomes the voice of orthodoxy, while Shambandhu, the father, is this in-between figure who's the emerging middle-class man, as I spoke about earlier.
Which will not be in the folktale.
This person who is moving. So, you see, why Fakir Mohan Senapati becomes important in his own context is also because he's able to talk about the transition that takes place in Odia life as well. The transition from feudal way of living to this new modern way of life, you know, which is being facilitated through education.
Which means he becomes from a writer to a social historian.
Yes.
He is presenting the scene of the times. And he's telling people, he's telling the readers that this is what is happening around them.
Yes.
So it's very educative activity.
In this sense, yes. I think, you know, the words that one has to keep in mind when one is talking about are also that, you know, he's talking about feudalism, he's talking about colonialism, and also talking about nationalism as also ethnicity. You see, these words are important in the context of Senapati because he's working around all these in a way. You know, he talks about the feudal way of life, talks about how zamindars are also exploitative, and then talks about the colonial, viewpoint, which does not take into account the Odia people at all, and then talk about the ethnicity, the community related issues, as also the larger issue of nationalism.
Which means that, would you agree when I say that he is using literature as a kind of social classroom?
In a way, yes, he is, because he is, as I said, he's a social reformer first, and he uses literature as a way through to express his point of view and to create awareness. You see, so literature becomes, and the folklore, the use of the folklore also then is important, because folklore has been with people all through. So he can easily play with the matter, he can easily play with the folklore and bring in new elements. So this particular point that, he uses the folklore, but then the short story form, in a way makes way into the folklore. He's not interested in solutions, because solutions don't exist. He's more interested in the problem and, you know, the kind of, and the tragedy that comes from that problem, you know. And this is exactly what he does also in his novel, 6 Acres and a Half, where, you know, he talks about the zamindari system and how, a person who's a villain. Now, there also, even, you know, he's not limiting. I think Fakir Mohan Senapati very consciously uses the folktale form. It's not something, it is something that he has probably grown up with. It has stayed with him and so has filtered in his works. But at the same time, he's using it consciously. Because when he writes a novel, even there he creates characters who are negative or positive. You know, he creates the character, the character of, a villain in the, in the novel. And, you know, its name is Mangaraj, Ramchandra Mangaraj. And the Mangaraj then is the villain of the story, who's fleecing everybody, who's drawing money. He becomes a big time, he's a small time person, but then he's a money lender. And he lends the money as also lends paddy, and when he lends these things, then he takes money and, you know, exploits people and makes money. Finally, he becomes a kind of a property zamindar. He's able to accumulate a lot of wealth. So this figure of Mangaraj is this villain figure, you know, if you see, and the tone of the narrator is so biting and so satirical in the novel, 6 Acres and a Half, that you feel that, you know, what he's saying and what he means, there is a stark difference. They are complete opposites, you know, in that sense. So, you see, there is this kind of the villain figure, and then there are these, you know, simple, innocent folk, you know, the weaver family that is, you know, that suffers, you know, in the novel. And finally, what happens to them is a tragic end. The man goes mad and the wife starves herself to death. So, you see, there's this kind of similarity in Rebati and in 6 Acres and a Half, where, you know, the weaver Bhagya is, you know, weaver the Bhagya is, you know, driven mad because his land is, you know, taken away, and he's driven out. His house is, you know, crushed, and he's, you know, it's auctioned, and finally it is, he's uprooted from the place. And the wife is also, starves herself to death. So there's a kind of tragedy inbuilt even in the novel. And that tragedy of innocent, simple people who are driven by, you know, older, you know, ideas of religion. And again, you know, why the weaver family, they wanted to build a temple because they wanted to have a child, and they wanted to please the goddess, the local goddess, and therefore they wanted to build a temple. And for that reason, they decided to take money from Mangaraj, who's a moneylender. Mangaraj makes them sign, he executes the bond, of the land bond, and you know, makes them sign it and everything. But then what he does, he doesn't give them the money, and in fact throws them out. This is what leads them to madness. And this was a fertile land that they had, and, you know, again a scene of happy plenitude that was built is completely, you know, is they're completely crushed. And that leads to their death. So, you know, so there's this kind of a villain figure that we have of Mangaraj here is presented throughout the text as, you know, as someone who is going to play that role of a negative character. But again, the folk tale comes in because he gives poetic justice. Now, what Senapati does is he wants to show that how evil deeds will lead to evil ends. So Mangaraj, who has fleeced many people, who has driven them to deaths, who has, you know, he's also fleeced another big zamindar. In fact, he makes him sign of a loan of 30,000 rupees. The figure of Sheikh Dildar Mia, who was a big zamindar, and who actually employed Mangaraj to take zamindari from the peasants. When Dildar Mia is drunk, he makes him sign a loan bond of 30,000 rupees, then uses the law, sues him, and then finally takes over that particular his land and zamindari as well. So we can see how this person has also used the law. Mangaraj in the story has in the novel has also used the law to his own advantage, and how the law has given him that kind of a facility, you know, where he's able to make a lot of money. But then when Mangaraj the weaver couple, they die, after that Mangaraj is put in the prison by the same law, by the English courts, because not for killing, not for taking the land, but for stealing the cow.
Can you throw some light on the relationship between the characters in the story, characters in the novel, and the author? which characters he approves of, which other characters he is critical about? Could you say something regarding this?
So again, those are very simple categories, in fact, you know, because he builds these kind of negative and positive characters. So the Mangaraj is a villain in the in the novel, but the narrator, you know, is talking in tongue-in-cheek. You know, he will say that, well, he's such a pure person, how can one doubt him, you know, and how can one think ill of Mangaraj? Of course, you know, he doesn't let people sell vegetables, only vegetables from his land will be sold, but of course, because they are better vegetables, you know, so he tries to poke fun, he's constantly doing that, but he's presenting Mangaraj as a negative figure. And figures of the weaver couple of Bhagya, they are the positive, innocent people in the novel. But the point is that, you know, the innocent, simple folk are very rare, are they rare and they're not around. Most of the people are clever and cunning.
Are some characters spokesperson of the author?
The narrator is a kind of a distant viewer, mm-hmm. you know, and who's looking at characters and the life, and therefore the narrator appears very close to the author in that sense. The narrator is very satirical, and you know, there's a lot of dark humor which exists in the novel, mm-hmm. and you know, he's using this kind of a humor, in fact, to show his disgust for this class that exists here, you know, in society, which is trampling upon others, taking the rights of others, and then building, you know, accumulating wealth. But then, you know, the author intervenes to give poetic justice in that sense. When Mangaraj, you know, is put in prison and his wife dies, so we see it's a kind of a agonizing tale of Mangaraj then. Because this person who was the villain earlier and who made others suffer and who caused misery to others is also left in a miserable state. And you know, this kind of it's a kind of a cycle that keeps going on. After Mangaraj is in the prison, his maidservant Champa, she gets hold of all the treasure and decides to run away to Cuttack with this kind of a wealth. And she goes with, the barber. And here on the way, Champa is killed by the barber, who again takes the money. So, you know, money travels from one hand to another, and, you know, there are people who are trying to play clever with one another, kill one another and take the money. So human lives as against the wealth, you know, they are being placed in a kind of a balance, and human lives is really cheap when it comes to, this kind of wealth that is moving in different hands. So Champa is killed by the barber servant, and here and he trying to preserve the wealth takes the wealth in her boat and drowns.
Please tell us in one sentence whether the writer is using the technique of realism. Is he?
The writer is definitely using the technique of realism, but he's not limiting himself to the technique of realism. Mm. Like in 6 Acres and a Half, he's using the picaresque mode as well. Mm. He's using different modes and different ways to say his things, but he's using the folklore. Now, how much of the folklore is realistic one is another question. You know, is folklore realistic? And therefore, so he uses the folklores, he uses certain elements of magic and others. He uses, the picaresque mode, but then his base is realistic because he's talking about the actual people and the life, the socio-economic life of the times.
I think it's a very good point regarding the role of art in the 19th century when the country was facing drought, was facing different crises at the level of society and economy. And the writer is able to give voice to the concerns of the time through his writing. Viewers, Dr. Bajaj's lecture has been very educative in the sense, you know, that we learn a lot about the 19th century in Odisha, the tensions at the level of society, at the level of culture, at the level of language, at the level of literature. And I think this lecture is going to be quite educative for viewers, you as well. And she has thrown up many questions, and these questions we have to go into and then form our own opinion on the basis of the points that are made here. Thank you, Dr. Bajaj, and viewers, you'll be asking questions later on. Think about these questions yourself and see whether the program is able to approach a kind of vision that finally will last. Thank you.